BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia. And how is everybody doing today? I hope you all are well. You know, I think this might be the first time that we've ever just done a promotion or announcement episode to talk about some of the material that we have available on this channel. We did one for the documentary Obsession Into Darkness, which is now available again. It's now been reposted on the Zodiac Killer channel, but that was because I was one of the contributors to that documentary. So once again, Obsession Into Darkness on the Zodiac Killer channel. Please check it out. But to talk about some of the material that we have here and some of the playlists that have been newly created, I would just like to just make everybody aware of the stuff that we have going on. The first and foremost thing that I would say is that in the description box, we will have a link to our playlist on Zodiac Unmasked by Robert Graysmith, and that is going to have a lot of new additions coming in the future. But in addition to that one, we will have the link to our 17-part series on Thomas Henry Horan and the Great Zodiac Killer Hoax of 1986. In addition to that, all the links are going to be posted in the box there. I also have one to our 9-part series on Earl Van Best. The book is The Most Dangerous Animal of All by Gary Stewart. And with that one, I know I want to promote this stuff and I want people to listen to the uploads, but I'm just telling you that you do not need to read that book. Everything that you want to know will be in that podcast series because it's like, I will save you the $8. I read that one, so you don't have to. And there's some very big specific reasons for that. And I think it's borderline trolling and insincerity in some points on the part of Gary Stewart. And if you'd like to know more about that, the link to our discussions on Gary Stewart and his book, The Most Dangerous Animal of All, talking about Earl Van Best as the Zodiac Killer, is here in the description box. Once again, I read it, so you don't have to, and you're welcome. But in terms of looking at some of the different angles to the case, if you've been following along with this stuff recently, last year on the channel, we took the channel in quite of a different direction. We weren't talking about the Zodiac Killer so much, but definitely more going down the serial killer pathways. And one of the reasons why was I learned about the suspect, Robert Christian Hansen. There is a very small group of people online that believe that Robert Christian Hansen was the Zodiac Killer. He was a serial killer from Alaska. I mean, he was actually born in the Midwest, but he moved to Alaska in 1967. He became known as the Butcher Baker. And I would have to say, and from the episodes that we did in 2019, that is perhaps one of the most fascinating cases that we did. I'm going to post a link to that. It's not exactly a playlist. It's a 2-part series that we have. The link should be pinned in. But the thing to say about that one is, I would hope that people would approach it as not so much a Zodiac killer suspect or a genuine suspect, but rather just learning about some of the things to do with serial killers, because that was when we really began to shift more toward like exploring the psychology of serial killers. And we were talking about the more famous cases such as Jeffrey Dahmer and Ted Bundy, as well as some of the lesser known cases such as people like Kathy Wood or Michael Ross. And that's like, as I said, that kind of brought the channel into a different direction. But overall, though, like one of the, I mean, just in terms of a fascinating story, I will have a link posted to our episodes. I almost said episodes, like upload an episode at the same time, our episodes on Robert Christian Hansen, the serial killer known as the Butcher Baker. And we do get into the Zodiac Killer connection because that's how I learned about him. Someone brought him to my attention, just really like it, you know, requesting to discuss this stuff in the comments section about the possibility of Robert Christian Hansen being the Zodiac Killer. And how did that one go? Well, you can hear about that. Link is in the description box there. When we're looking at the Zodiac Killer, though, I would really think that we should always bear in mind that the Zodiac is so much more than just simply like who killed these 5 people in the 1960s, who committed these other crimes from 1968 to possibly 1970, or you can even go back to 1966 or earlier if you're going to talk about the murder of Sherry Jo Bates. I mean, someone left us one comment in the comment section when they were saying that they never get bored with the Zodiac case. No, I don't either, because there's so many different angles about this, that so many different ways that you could explore. It's not only the identity of the killer, but then you would have to solve the ciphers. Then you would have to look at where were the errors in the police investigation that allowed this thing to go on as long as it did. So what I would say about all of this is, as we continue our discussions on the Zodiac Killer, I would all like to just really look at what was the San Francisco Police Department doing in 1968, 69, and 70. I mean, when we're dealing with the book Zodiac Unmasked, I mean, at the sections where we are now, it's getting all the way up to 1972, and you can still see the investigative process going on. And either people are making some serious errors, or they were just simply outsmarted by the Zodiac Killer. But a big thing, though, that I think is also just very important to note is how exactly do these things affect other people? And people do perceive this in the media. Like when we even did an upload last year on Eddie Sada, who was the New York Zodiac. He was a copycat, someone in his early 20s, mind you, who composed this thing about killing people with different zodiac signs. And he learned this way to create ciphers. And he, like, the fact that he was in his early 20s, that's always stood out to me. Like, perhaps with the Zodiac Killer, we aren't really dealing with somebody in their late 40s or early 40s. I mean, I don't necessarily know 100%, but I'll go ahead and include a link to the upload on the New York Zodiac copycat, Eddie Sada. With the things on Robert Christian Hansen and Eddie Sada, those are done in more of the old-fashioned way of doing things on the channel at what I call pure podcast format, the gray box of podcasting. But one of the things that I found when I listen to YouTube podcasts, and I listen to YouTube podcasts all the time, we're talking like every single day. If I'm not like, you know, on my other phone or on the computer and I just got the audio playing, then I just put the closed captions on and I find that it really allows me to focus in much more easily. But, you know, the Zodiac did lead to potentially other copycats around the world. And we could talk about a few more of those things on this channel. When we're looking at Thomas Henry Horne and the Zodiac Killer hoaxer, as I said, we have the 17-part playlist here in the description box. With that one, I would say that, I mean, I have so many mixed feelings about it because it's not really a hoax. We've said that so many times, though. It's like the first two things might start out as a Zodiac hoax, but then by September of 1969, it takes on a life of its own, and a real serial killer does form, or a real perpetrator in the Zodiac mystery does take place. And that's, of course, getting into people like Dennis Land, as well as possibly Hal Snook, who, by Thomas Horne's own admission, could have been the Presidio Heights shooter of October 11th, 1969, killing Paul Stein. So when we're looking at that one, I mean, I listened back to the interview that I did with Thomas Horan a couple days ago, and there was one line that just jumped out at me, saying that Thomas Horan got into this by looking at the police reports and believing that the perpetrator, or the by the perpetrator, we mean the person writing the Zodiac letters, must have had access to those police reports, and then the person writing the letters must have known something that not even the killer would have known. And he says this because there was an individual named Andy Nicolatis. I always want to say Andy Milonakis, but his name was Andy Nicolatis Jr., who was seen by the Lake Herman Road shooting of December 20th, 1968, and he went by very calmly, but he was investigated and turned out that he had nothing to do with the Lake Herman Road shooting that killed Betty Lou Jensen and David Faraday. So then, but he was noted in the police report as being there. Then in the Zodiac letter that came after Blue Rock Springs talking about Lake Herman Road, the Zodiac says, "I didn't leave with screeching tires and spinning out of there. I left very calmly." So then Thomas Horan began to think, hey, wait a second, the person writing these letters must have had access to the police reports. But, you know, the person who actually committed those crimes wouldn't know that. So then he's like, the things in the police reports are stuff that the killer wouldn't know because Andy Nicolatis Jr. was not involved with this. And then I just began to think, now, wait a second, that whole little rambling spiel there, what if that's just a coincidence? What if, I mean, the Zodiac wrote that in the letter, but he didn't have access to the police report? I mean, that's not a complicated piece of information. I actually left quietly. Boom, stop. End of discussion. I mean, what if that is something that pushed Thomas Horan down the wrong pathway? I'm not saying that he's wrong 100%. I said that very clearly. That's a what if. But I mean, I think the Zodiac Killer hoax theory is absolutely fascinating. And here's something that we can say in a praiseworthy fashion. Thomas Horan, and you can hear all about more of this in the Great Zodiac Killer Hoax playlist that we have in the description box, talks about how he can connect his suspects to the crime scenes. When you're looking at Zodiac Killer suspects like Lawrence Kane and Ross Sullivan, and to an extent, Richard Gajkowski as well, it's like, how do you get this person to the crime scene? And this is also explored in the book, The Most Dangerous Animal of All, by Gary Stewart. Gary Stewart does put forward explanations about how he connects Earl Van Best to the crime scene, but there are a few problems with that, and you can hear about it in the series. But the thing is, though, I mean, like, when it comes to suspects, as we said, like Lawrence Kane and Ross Sullivan, I mean, Richard Gajkowski, apparently someone said they did find his glasses near one of the crime scenes. I don't know too much about that. The person who was making that YouTube video didn't provide too many specifics on how he obtained that information. Maybe it's somewhere else out there. But with a lot of Zodiac Killer suspects, how do you get that person to the crime scene on that particular day? And to the credit of Thomas Horan, he can provide that type of information through certain police documentation, by his own admission, talking about the people that he believes committed the Lake Herman Road shooting, Russell Ott, either that or possibly David Ott, and then the Blue Rock Springs shooting committed by either Donald Warren Porter or Jim Phillips Crabtree, Darlene Farren's ex-husband. So, I mean, he has proposed something that he can back up with certain statements. But as we see, though, through our discussions of him on this channel and the interview that we did as well, I mean, with the interview that we did on Thomas Henry Horan, it's arranged into a four-part playlist. The first three parts of the interview and the fourth part of the playlist is the set of follow-up notes that I did, just like my response to my discussion with him. It is just very simply that there are some things there that I believe are missing that other people in the comments section are saying very clearly they believe are missing. And Thomas Horan, by his own admission, says that he is aware that certain things in his theory are missing. Once again, that does not mean that he is wrong, because I don't know everything. I don't have 100% absolute certainty that, no, this is everything that happened in the Zodiac Killer case. But I'm hoping to continue the book discussions with the Zodiac Killer, and we can look at how a lot of these things are going to be spread out in a variety of different directions, because that's something that's very valuable. And even just if we're going to listen to all different points of view, we've talked about some Zodiac Killer suspects on this channel, like Bruce Davis, for example, who was a member of the Manson family. And we can look at some of those other ways like that are connected. Like one Zodiac Killer suspect that we've never done was Ted Kaczynski. We did a four-part playlist on the Unabomber Manifesto, but I mean, I won't include that into the description box here with some with the other links that we have available, because I mean that's not exploring the Zodiac connections. I personally don't believe that Ted Kaczynski was the Zodiac Killer, because he was out of the state on a handful of Zodiac incidents, during a handful of Zodiac incidents, we should say. But there are some people that still to this day believe that Ted Kaczynski was the Zodiac Killer. But we could talk about some of those things like that, because the thing that I always say is, if you can challenge somebody, if you can debunk somebody, if you can provide something to the contrary, if you can do a little bit of investigation and you can learn something that disputes a fact, well, then just do it. What's stopping you? Sometimes it becomes very frustrating just to always hear, no, I'm not going to talk about it because it's ridiculous. Granted, though, I think that maybe sometimes you can say that, but not always. There are a few Zodiac suspects that are perhaps more famous that I haven't really talked about too much, but if anyone has anything that they would like discussed on the channel, you can always drop your suggestion in the comments below. You know, but we are getting pretty loaded with topics, and one big thing to say is we're pretty much going to do every other day is going to be related to the Zodiac Killer until we can finish some of the book discussions. And that means we are going to be having other topics going on the channel. And when I first started this thing, Black Box Online Radio, I really just wanted to be like, any subject is fair game. Anything is open to discussions. So, I mean, that's exactly the way the channel is going to be going. It's just that we've got caught up with a lot with these Zodiac Killer discussions, the same way that last year we really got caught up with talking about serial killers. But, you know, we really did a variety of subjects in the earlier parts of 2019, getting a lot into William Cooper, the host of The Hour of the Time, as well as the author of Behold a Pale Horse, which is perhaps what he's more famous for. And those were some great things. We did this little 8-minute segment talking about William Cooper and the epidemic of tyranny, and it's like that was one of my absolute favorite uploads from 2019. So, I mean, it's good to have that type of stuff going on because, I mean, like, we can't only focus in on one thing. And I've said this many times on the channel. One of my all-time favorite subjects is conspiracy theory science. Like, what is the functionality of a conspiracy theory? How does it operate? What is going on with it? And we did a book discussion this year on Jonathan Kay and Among the Truthers, and there were some great things in there. It's like, I don't necessarily think that Jonathan Kay is somebody that I would be friends with after listening to a handful of interviews, some of his debates, book discussions, and like promotional things that he did for his book Among the Truthers. But we do talk about that subject from time to time. Hey, that stuff just isn't going to go anywhere because it's some of the most fascinating things in the world. And do you ever just get into that world of just like being curious about the motivations about why people do things? And what I said was, when Dr. Phil, of all people, said that he didn't only want to know someone's motivations, he wanted to know what people were thinking when they did it. And all I have to say about that is, well, when you're dealing with a lot of true crime cases, I mean, many people often say that they don't even remember the events as they took place because they are so overwhelmed with adrenaline. People do have blackouts because they get so consumed in the true crime incident. That's why I was so much more drawn toward the motivation. Why do people do certain things? And you can apply that to things, as in, why do people think in certain ways? And when you're looking at the Zodiac Killer, I'd say that there's a very valuable discussion that you can have with that. What were the motivations that led people to be involved with the Zodiac or led the Zodiac to commit the crimes? Once again, you can deal with the group murder theory or the single killer theory. And some of the things that you could say is you could be dealing with a person who was trying to restore a broken ego. You could be dealing with a person who hated women. You could be dealing with a person who just thought that he was the most brilliant thing that ever existed. He wanted to be the Zoion, the animal, the greatest animal of all, the most dangerous animal of all. So he wanted to hunt other people for sport because he thought he could get away with it. Or it could be everything to the contrary. And it really is a mystery to always learn what are other people thinking. Well, I think that's going to be wrapping up this discussion here. I know this is all over the map, but as we said, this is mostly a promotional piece. We're going to be talking about some of the other things that we have on this channel. Once again, I would like to invite everybody to listen to our Zodiac Killer discussion on Robert Graysmith and Zodiac Unmasked. We'll have a link to the playlist in the description box, and new episodes will be added to that one. We also have our 6-part series on Gareth Penn and his book Time 17, as well as the 17-part series on Thomas Henry Horan. The Gareth Penn one is shorter because online that book was divided into 4 parts, and we only did one on the fourth on the first part, so we could get into the book discussion on Zodiac Unmasked. But we do have a 6-part series on Gareth Penn and Time 17. Then we have the one on Gary Stewart and Susan Mustafa, who wrote the book The Most Dangerous Animal of All. And like I encourage you to listen and just see what you think for yourself, as well as some other things we got on our, such as our interview with Thomas Henry Horan, and just some of the bonus episodes that we can throw in there. Robert Christian Hansen, the serial killer, the butcher baker, exploring some Zodiac connections, as well as Eddie Sada, the New York Zodiac. The Eddie Sada one is a standalone episode, and as we said, Robert Christian Hansen is a 2-part episode, one of the absolute most fascinating things that I learned about last year. All right, well, once again, this is totally just like a commercial, more or less. We don't really do commercials on BBOR, but just talking about some of the material that we have out there. And later this week, we will be continuing our discussions about Zodiac Unmasked by Robert Graysmith and looking at a few more of the books that are surrounding the Zodiac Killer, as well as the the entirety of what was going on with California in the 1960s and 70s. There's some crazy stuff there. Well, that's all for me now. Until next time.